I am Sam Pansino, and we're here at Exotic Limo for Insane TV, the show about modified cars and custom car audio systems. On this week's episode, we've got Insane Gear, where Brett reviews this really cool in-dash dyno gadget, so stay tuned for that one. We also have Insane Hands, where we show you how to fine-tune that Torno kit that we fitted last week to the VY Ute, so we'll see how we do the fine detailing on that. We also have a really cool feature car. But first up, it's the Brett Files! I'm Stupid Sam.
I'm Brett. And due to budget constraints, the microphone has been taken away from me. I keep breaking them every time I grab them, so no more grabbing of the microphone for the Brett Files. This is the Brett Files, this is Fat Audio Concepts, and I'm Brett.
I'm Stupid Sam.
Hi, Stupid Sam.
And I want to know about amplifiers. How to wire them up.
I can tell you all about amplifiers and how to wire them up. We have covered amplifiers before.
Yeah.
Yes, last week.
Yep. But well, we covered subs as well. We've covered really much everything. I just want to know, when I go to wire it up, what do I have to do?
Well, obviously, amplifier needs power. And to get the power to it, you need the power wires. I've got some examples of power wires here. Depending on the level of amplifier that you're running, you know, if you're just running a simple...
four-channel single amp.
A little amplifier, you know, you can get away with even some 8-gauge power cable. This is 8-gauge, good for up to about 50 amps worth of current draw. So again, a nice little amplifier will run fine on a bit of 8-gauge.
But if you want to juice it up a bit and have your amp running just a bit more balls?
Yeah, then you would go with some 4-gauge. This is Stinger's HPM, which is the Hyper series of the power cable. This stuff is awesome. It's really, really flexible. Normally you can't do this with another power cable.
That's pretty cool. Does that restrict the power flow?
No, not at all.
Cool.
Yeah, it's great stuff.
There you go. So that's good
tying
for...
Tying it in a knot is not good. That can build up some internal resistance.
As you do, because you're extra length that you don't really need.
Exactly.
So the trick is not to wind it up under your seat.
No, don't wind it up. Just cut it to the length that you need it. The shorter the run, the better.
Cool. Now, can I run two amps off a 4-gauge? If that were just like, you know, a couple of entry-level amps,
yeah.
You know, one's running the front speakers, the other one's running just a entry-level sub, would I get away with a 4-gauge?
Yeah, definitely. 4-gauge, again, it's going to be able to flow quite a bit of current, you know, up to sort of 150 amps worth of current.
Yep.
So definitely you could, you know, run a bit of 4-gauge. You'd use a distribution block, which is basically like a T-piece.
Yeah.
Not necessarily a T-piece, but a disc.
Whatever shape it may be.
Yes, whatever piece. it will distribute the power to however many amps you need. Usually, from a 4-gauge, you would split it down to two of the 8-gauge.
And just as a safety side of things as well, should my earth be the same size as the power coming in? Like, I don't want to run a 3mm earth, even though it's a short run, and I'm running a 4-gauge in. That's just going to kill it, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. You need the whatever's going into the amp to be able to flow out. It needs to be able to return.
Yeah.
So it's like having a big fire hose. You've got a massive hose that can pump out volume of water. If you've only got a small nozzle on the end, not much water's going to come out. It's the same with power cable. You need to have the same amount coming out.
Yep, that way you get it cycling through.
Exactly.
Now, if I go for two big current drawing amps, like if I've got two big suckers, I know a couple of PDXs could probably run off a 4-gauge, but to do it efficiently, you probably want to run a 0-gauge.
You definitely want to run a 0-gauge. Here we have some 0-gauge here. This is again Stinger's Pro Series in 0-gauge.
Now we're getting serious.
There's some big chunky wire.
Yep.
You know, in excess of 300 amps, this stuff will flow. So,
if I'm doing like a 3, 4, 5 amp system.
We are doing a 5-amp system in a car.
Amazing. There you go.
So we're definitely running a 0-gauge run in that car.
Yeah.
It already has a 0-gauge run in there. And we'll be using all of that to run the 5 amplifiers.
Killer. Now, what about with my head unit? It's got a remote on trigger.
Yes.
Apparently, I've heard rumors, and I'm not sure if they're true, so I'm asking you because you're the electrical nerd. If I'm running 3 or more amplifiers, is my remote trigger off the head unit going to be safe?
Look, generally, no. I would suggest if you're running more than 2 amplifiers, to run them off a relay.
Okay.
So use the remote wire from your amplifier, from your head unit, sorry. You could run a piece of this, which is a bit of 3mm or even 2mm wire, then low current doesn't need, it's not supplying any current, it's just a trigger.
It's just a turn-on trigger, basically. Exactly. So when the head unit turns on, it sends a trigger down the wire saying, hey, turn on your amps.
Yep.
But instead, we're going to turn on a relay.
We need to turn on one of these. This is a normal, what they call a changeover relay. Basically, this one here is what they call this is a changeover. It has two states, so normally closed and normally open. So when the relay is sitting here, as it is with no power on anything, that pin there, which is pin 30, is connected to pin 87A. And then what you would do is the trigger coming from your head unit goes onto pin 85. Pin 86 there goes to ground. And that's basically just a high current switch, which will then connect that pin there to there, and that runs to your amplifier to power it up.
So all your 5 amps just run off 87.
Yep.
And that's it. You're pretty well saved yourself, because it's as long as your 30 power comes from your distribution block or something. Yeah.
Or a high current source.
Oh, killer. There you go.
Yeah. And then you've got, obviously, once you've got the power side looked at, you need to look at signal side.
RCA cables.
RCA cables.
Pretty important. Don't run cheapies.
Don't run cheapies. If you want, unless of course you want engine noise.
You don't want to have a turbocharger in your audio system.
Yeah.
Make sure you get yourself some decent RCAs, because I've heard rumors that a good RCA can stop a lot of system noise.
Definitely. Well, we've got recommend the Stinger brand of RCAs. They got the Pro 3s. Great RCAs. Twisted pair. Really good signal, run the signal really well and cancel out a lot of the noise as well.
That's for every time they cross over, when it twists, every crossover is a 90-degree twist and it cancels out any humming sound.
Exactly.
So, way to go.
And then you've also got speaker wiring as well. So you're looking at 16-gauge speaker wire for, say, tweeters and mid-range speakers.
Yeah.
Things don't need a lot of current. Speakers still need current.
Yeah.
Still an analog signal. And then bit of 12 gauge or bigger to run things like mid bass drivers and subwoofers.
Ah, cool.
So again, the bigger cable, same as a power cable, can flow more power.
So, and if you want to get a bit serious, you could even use the 8 gauge for subwoofer power cable.
Definitely.
I've seen that done a few times.
Yeah, well, we've used 8 gauge before on some big DV systems, and we've also used metal rods on some cars as well.
Well, that's the wiring all sorted out, knowing what I need, but can you show me how to pre-tune my amplifier before I put it in, so I know that I've already got it where it needs to be?
Yeah, I can. Well, how about we'll save that for next week?
That sounds like a plan. That sounds like a plan.
Sorry, guys. All right, well, that was the Brett Files for this week. Hope you enjoyed it. I'm Brett. That's Stupid Sam.
Hey.
Bad Audio Concepts and the Brett Files.
See you next week.
See ya.
Ciao. Thanks for that, Brett. Informative as per usual. But now it's time for Insane Hands. Let's go and have a look. Right. What we're going to do here now is show you how to adjust the motor. Brett's going to take the motor off for us. Thanks, Brett. I'll get out of the light. Okay. Now we look how to adjust these motors. If we take a closer look here, I'm going to give it a big zoom in. Okay, looking carefully, you can see the texture mark up here. What we do is we can pull that down and turn it one tooth that way, or one tooth, or quite a few teeth. Every tooth that you turn is an extra centimeter of travel in time. So what we need to do is we're going to wind this in.
We want to bring this in two turns, just to pull down a bit on the tonneau lid, just to really tighten it down. But to then to compensate for the length we need, we actually need to wind this out by probably another 2 centimeters. So we want to go two teeth.
What we're trying to do here is get the tonneau lid to hold down better. And in order to do that, we need to bring the motor in further. To bring the motor in further, we need to wind this in, but only wind it in when the motor's in. If you wind it in while it's out and you overturn it, then as the motor goes all the way in, it'll bottom out and try and spin on itself. So only wind these in when the motor's compressed. And on top of that, once you wind that in, you then have to adjust it down below here as well. We just lift it into shot there. So you can see there's a little texture mark out of factory. Once you pop these little black covers off, there's just three little screws. And all you do is you pull that down and adjust it one tooth. You'll see there's a little cam lobe underneath. that's just your timer. Basically, once it hits that, it'll stop the motor from spinning. So we just, because we want that to go out a few more seconds, we just pop that down, turn it one tooth. One tooth will give you an extra centimeter of travel. So all right, let's wind this in.
Wind that in. It's one turn. That's two. That's brought it in about a centimeter. So we'd probably want to now adjust this out 1 centimeter.
So just one tooth forward. And that's it.
So you can see now the little texture mark is now offset, and you can see that's wound out by one more tooth.
So now we can put this back in, make sure it moves up and down correctly. Because what we want to do is when the torno lid comes down, we want it nice and hard. Don't want it to flap around, but we don't want it so hard that it's going to rip the brackets out of the lid itself. So we'll try this back in and see how we go. Done. And once you're finished, hit a button, and then she comes again. Beautiful. Well, have you enjoyed it? Laters. That was the Insane Hands. Now it's time to have a look at what's happening in the workshop tour. Looking at the front of the hearse, we've now got the Statesman front end on. It required new guards, new bar, new headlights, new bonnet, new grill, new badge, new bonnet release, new spotlights, new under tray, new bar iron, new everything. So just to change your car and update the front end ain't the easiest thing to do, but when it's done, just makes the car look so super classy. So it's just, yeah, really finished this car off. The paintwork as well is a really, really, really nice metallic, like a black going on grey or a grey going on black. It's really nice metallic, but once again, you need to get this car out in the sunlight to really appreciate it. The Statesman headlights, they've got the HIDs in there. These things just, yeah, they're absolutely beautiful. The factory lights look, well, they look like factory, just very boring, plain, big, chunky light. These Statesman ones, the way they've got the black inside helps highlight the body as well. Gives it that whole custom light look, even though it's yet a factory headlight. It's like a nice factory headlight, even for a Holden, which is pretty hard for me to admit that a Holden looks good, but this looks good. Then you got the grill. To get these grills on, they're an absolute nightmare. The clips are a pain in the butt. Good one, Holden. But once it's all on, you got the release underneath that's a bit tricky to get to. But yeah, with a bit of manipulating, this whole car now looks like it was a Statesman ute slash hearse. So that's just come up an absolute treat. You also have to change the big windage tray underneath. There's a tray that goes all the way to the, basically the cross member, and it supports the whole bottom of the bar. So now this is all nice and tight and doesn't move. So it's just come up an absolute treat. And once again, just the chrome little highlights on this help it make it look like a really nice luxury car. I mean, being a hearse, you want to make sure you're traveling in comfort. It's your last ride, so you might as well go out in style, don't you think? So yeah, and then we've also got the spotlights underneath there as well. The spotlights, once again, Holden just using the chrome bezels, like the chrome rings around the edges. They've done it on the headlights, they've done it on the spotlight, around the grill flute as well. It's just showing you they're looking for cosmetic integration themselves. So the guys designing this are doing a bloody awesome job from, you could say, a spectator's point of view. Well, I hope you liked it. Let's keep moving on. The Mustang, yet another one. Love these cars, they're just timeless shape. No matter how old they get, they still look bloody cool. We're going for probably a bit hard to see because we don't have enough lighting, but it's a super red. It's actually called super red. So this car's gonna look like a really nice deep blood red. So picture that on this, mouth watering. The wheels on this car look awesome as well. They suit the era of the car. So he hasn't gone for the big billet look. He's gone for more of the original factory look back in its era. So yeah, we'll see how this thing comes up next week. Here we have the 64 Impala. It doesn't look like much because unfortunately the back half of this car was torn off in a massive accident. The thing used to be a street rod. and the owner unfortunately flipped the car, barrel rolled it and tore the back half of the car off. The front half was salvageable, there's a big word for you. So the new owner of the front half of this car has decided to turn it into a barbecue. So if we look carefully here, yeah! This thing's gonna be on hinges, it'll lift up like so, and back down again. Like a glove. We'll watch this thing come along and we'll get some photos. He's got the whole front end all being re-chromed. There's gonna be two twin fake air cleaners hanging out the top of the bonnet. This is gonna be one of the best barbecues in Australia, I tell you. So, good work, Brad. This thing's gonna rock. Let's keep going. Wow. God, Vito can paint. Take a look at all this stuff. What we've got here is a lot of stuff. This is all for the Orion demo car, the XR5 Turbo. We're gonna have this thing completed shortly. These panels, we've got pieces of glass made to the exact same size with the Orion logo etched into it from behind. We're gonna light it up with some red LEDs and they're just basically gonna sit inside there, but there'll be a sheet of glass in front of that, so that way once that goes on the car, it's gonna look so classy and lit up in red just for a few little red highlights. It's gonna look sporty, gonna look classy without being too messy. So we haven't done a full fiberglass door trim, just highlighted the pods. We've also done the tweeters on the A-sail. Here's a set I prepared earlier. So you can see even the tweeter itself, we've just done where the speaker goes in white and kept the original black plastic panel there. When that sits on the door, it just gives it a bit of a highlight to say, hey, there's a tweeter here without saying, oh my God, what a wanker. This thing's gonna look totally awesome, dude. And it's gonna sound just as good because the old XTR gear used to rock. The new gear rocks even harder and we're gonna prove it. We have our front door pods. We have our mini rear door pods. So and the rear ones have their little back panel as well. And in the rear windows, we're gonna have XTR because the Orion gear is all XTR. Basically, it's a rebirth of the original hard-hitting stuff from many years ago. So we're hanging to see what this stuff actually sounds like. We move to the next table, we'll show you what the rear speakers are mounted into. This is the rear side pod, if you will. This is mounted to the side of the sub box, which you'll see shortly as well. 5 1/4 mounts in here, tweeter up top. The crossover is gonna sit at the back. So this is gonna keep the speaker firing in its own sealed chamber to help keep it controlled. That way, even out the back, you're gonna get some crazy sound. So when the hatch is up, these speakers switch on. As soon as the hatch is shut, it actually shuts off the little hatch switch for the light, shuts off the amplifier at the same time, so that way the rear speakers don't work while the hatch is down. The rear door speakers will, but the rear hatches won't. The second you open the hatch, all the lights come on, amp comes on, rear volume comes out. There's also a 12-inch monitor in between the two 12-inch subs, which we'll have a look at in a sec. And we've had a little fascia panel carbon fiber wrapped to suit the front fascia as well. So we're going to have a look at the sub box now. Come on. Now, if you watched Insane Hands last week, we showed you how to actually fiberglass, and the week before we showed you how to grill cloth. This is the finished product. It's got two-pack paint all over it. We've got the slots ready to go for the slot ports, those Perspex ones that we've had made up. They're about 12 mil thick, and they're gonna be backlit with some red LEDs, so all you'll see here is a really nice red glow, and that's what these wires are for. Other wires are for the subs. And on top of that, there's gonna be a 12-inch monitor in the middle here with a nice fascia that sits in there like so. Now, being that there's some carbon fiber around the head unit and around the console, we thought we'd run some carbon fiber around the back as well, just to bring the front into the back of the car as well. And this is all trimmed thanks to Nick at Exotic Customs. He's got this new carbon fiber wrap that it actually looks like woven carbon fiber. This stuff is absolutely amazing. It's not cheap, but damn, it looks like the real thing. So Nick, top job as per usual. It's absolute treat, makes our work look good. I mean, our work already looks good, but makes our work look gooder. There's some English for you. Cool. I'm not even sure what to call this car. Vito's Daily. We've now decided what audio system we're gonna go for. We're doing an Alpine Type-X Pro system. So to start off with, the first thing you have to do is roadkill a car. If you listen to the sound of it, very tinny, a bit more solid, solid as a brick. And if you look inside, look how much roadkill is on this puppy. We've got the block-off panels inside, we've got the sound deadening sheets, This thing, when you shut it, it shuts like a Lexus. Just listen to that. That's solid, man. This car, once the mid-bass drivers go in the door, the tight response that we're gonna get running off a couple of PDX amplifiers, this car's just gonna thump like there's no tomorrow. So also, what we're waiting to do is get the back wheels off the car. We're gonna measure up. We're going for 24 by 10s on the back and 22 by 8s on the front. Then we're gonna dump the absolute hell out of this on airbags. Then it's time to do some crazy painting, a bit of a custom motorized rear tarp. Thanks to AKI and their Streaker motorized torno kits. So it should be awesome. Right, let's keep moving on. That was our workshop tour. Now it's time for Insane Gear. Let's check what Brett's got. Come on.
On Insane Gear this week, we're looking at Virtual Instruments VT monitor. Basically, this unit here is what they call an OBD2 monitor. OBD2 meaning onboard diagnostics. Nearly every car now has a plug on it that will let you plug one of these monsters in. It'll log all your information out of the car's computer, performance data, engine management, that sort of thing. Basically what you can do, couple of things, monitor your RPM and your speed in a digital format. You can monitor up to, you know, three or four different types of engine conditions like oil temperature, pressure, whatever the car's computer will output. It also has a built-in three-axis G-meter. What that basically means is it knows how much pressure has been put on it side to side, forward and backwards. What that does is when it's plugged into your car and set upright, is it measures G-forces in the car, which in turn can give you performance from the car. It'll do 0 to 100 kilometer hour times, quarter mile times, 0 to 100 kilometers an hour, and then back to zero times. And it does that via that three-axis movement. The beauty about this little machine as well is it'll do vehicle fault code diagnostics. If you get your little check engine light flashing up a code on the dashboard and you don't know what it means and you don't really want to take it down to your local dealer that want to charge you $400 a shot, this unit will tell you exactly what the code means. And a lot of the cases, it will actually reset that code for you as well. If it's a intermittent problem or if it's something that you see that there's a problem, you can then fix it and reset the code so it doesn't keep flashing it up. Beautiful little product this. Mounts onto the windscreen with a suction cup mount similar to a portable GPS unit, and also plugs into the cigarette lighter, so it's a plug and play thing. You just enter in a few little bits of information like the vehicle, how heavy it is. If you don't know how heavy it is, usually it'll be in your owner's manual, or in Victoria it's actually written on your rego sticker, so you can tell how heavy your car is. It'll also store up to 500 hours of logging data, so you know you don't even have to be monitoring things manually. You can, if you do, let's say a track day, stick this on the dashboard, drive around for the track, come back and see exactly what your car's been doing while you're on the track. It's a beautiful way of making sure that you're not losing oil pressure around corners, things like that can really damage an engine. It also has, speaking of the track, built-in lap timer as well. So you can, as you go past the lap, you just tap the screen and it'll restart like a stopwatch. Once you've finished on the track, you can upload your lap times via the USB onto your computer. It also has rev and speed warning lights as well. Rev being a shift light, so you know when to change gears. You don't have to be watching the tacho on the car. It'll flash a little light on the screen so you know that's exactly when you need to change. Beautiful bit of gear here for only $649. Great value for money. Definitely save a costly engine blow up on a track day, as well as giving you peace of mind that your engine's doing exactly what it should be. That's the VT monitor. Hope you enjoyed Insane Gear this week. Till next week, we'll see you then.
And now, my favorite, the feature car. We're gonna go and have a look at this one. You're gonna love it. Let's go and have a look. The Dodge Challenger SRT8. Is there a sexier car? I don't think so. This thing is just sex on wheels. Quick story about the Dodge. When they built this thing, they just came out all guns blazing. Most car companies release the base model first, and then a year later they come out with their top line. Not Dodge. They said, you know what, 6,400 SRTs, and then we'll release the base model. This is build number 33. And yeah, out of the first 38 built, this is straight off the assembly line. So this is the first of the Dodge Challengers. Let's take a look. This baby runs a 6.1 litre V8 Hemi. It's an absolute monster of an engine. We're talking 425 horsepower at about 6,000 RPM and 420 foot-pounds of torque at about 4,800 RPM. So this baby's got some serious pulling power. It's also running a 5-speed auto. The gearbox in this thing's just absolutely tricked out. In actual fact, the running gear in this car is exactly the same running gear as the SRT 300C Chryslers. They literally share the same mechanicals, just different body shells. So we've got the same Brembo brakes, we've got the same gearbox, diff, motor, the whole lot. These things are just absolute weapons. But let's check out the rest of the car. Checking out the back of the car, this thing just looks as sexy at the back as it does at the front. Got our nice little spoiler, our SRT 8 badge, just to let you know you're rolling with some serious power, which also it's rolling on 20s out of factory. It's pretty damn cool. This car's just a monster all around. Got some crazy exhaust tips as well. You can't really modify these cars because they're already done for you out of factory. It's just, once again, sex on wheels. If you need a real muscle car, here she is. If you had to toss up between the Camaro and the Dodge, it'd be a hard choice, but I think the Dodge is going to win. But we'll prove that by showing you Camaro later on down the track. So yeah, I think it's time we go and check out what's happening inside the car. You wanna? Yeah, let's go. Checking out the interior of this monster. It's very 300C-ish to start with, but then, you know, you look at these seats, they're a lot different to the actual 300C. The seats are really nice leather, absolutely sexual. This thing's got front splits as well. We've got a 6-inch in the actual door. We've got a tweeter up on the dash. We've got a head unit that runs DVD with sat-nav control as well, which by the time we're finished with it, it'll work in Australia because we're going to be changing it to the Alpine series. But unfortunately, the Americans have put the steering wheel on the wrong side. So hopefully by the time we get this car, this steering wheel is actually going to be on my side where it needs to be. And then we'll show you more of this car, how we start to graph the audio system in it. It's going to be pretty damn cool. That was this week's feature car. Hope you enjoyed it. We'll see you next time. Well, that wraps up this week's episode. Hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week on Insane TV. Ciao. I'd like to remind you about joining our Facebook group. Just search for Fad Audio Concepts, join, and chat with other car enthusiasts. Leave questions and comments and feedback for either myself or Brett, and we'll do the best to incorporate your feedback into the show. So this thing's going to look awesome. Edit. This thing's going to look totally awesome, dude. What do you call that black stuff between elephants' toenails? Slow natives. Yeah, man, slow natives. They didn't move fast enough. Okay, bad joke. Moving right along. And if we move along to the next bench, we'll show you where, well, basically. So we got the front door pods. Don't forget to edit. And why can't Barbie get pregnant? Because Ken comes in a separate box. That's just not right. And what has two legs and bleeds like crazy? Half a dog. Okay, compressors off.
Okay, three.